Now you don't have to stay linked to your desktop or laptop. Take Voice America on the go and listen anywhere. Get our mobile app for iPhone, BlackBerry, or Android at the Apple iTunes App Store, BlackBerry App World, or Android Market.
The following program is being brought to you on the Voice America Business Channel. For more information about our network and to check our additional show hosts and topics of interest, please visit voiceamericabusiness.com. The Voice America Talk Radio Network is the worldwide leader in live internet talk radio. Visit voiceamerica.com. The views and ideas expressed on the following program are strictly those of the host or guests and do not necessarily reflect the views and ideas held by the Voice America Talk Radio Network, its staff, and management.
Welcome to Disabilities at Work Radio, where every week we explore issues, ideas, initiatives, and innovations involving the employment of people with disabilities. We feature employers that go beyond compliance in supporting people with disabilities in the workplace and elsewhere. We bring you prominent members of the business community, service providers, government officials, researchers, educators, and people who successfully manage their disability and careers. Join us now for Disabilities at Work.
Hello, I'm Ray Zardetto, and welcome to Disabilities at Work Radio here on the Voice America Business Network. Our program today is sponsored by the Kessler Foundation and the New Jersey Division of Disability Services. And today's show is going to focus on the journey of John Kirkwood. John Kirkwood worked for the City of New York for 14 years, first as an environmental engineer and then as a new media strategist. He developed New York City's first major website and was instrumental in launching websites for the Department of Environmental Protection, the Department of Health, and the Administration for Children's Services. And at the same time, he started his own internet company, which he called City Mouse, and he was beginning to build a healthy clientele of nonprofit companies and other clients. And then in 1996, without warning, it all changed radically for John Kirkwood. So, John,
sorry,
why don't we start
2006.
With that?
I'm sorry.
2006. I'm sorry. Why don't you pick it up from there?
Yes, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off, but that was...
Yes, 2006, yes.
Yes, 2006. I suffered from an aneurysm and stroke that reset my brain in a lot of ways, reset my visual orientation, reset the way that I taste, the way that I smell, and the way that I access and use memory. And I went through years of rehabilitation to get back to a point where I could begin to function again in society. And my new mission is to increase the awareness of disabilities online and start a company that's focused around accessibility of online services.
I'm just curious, when you go back and you look at 2006 and what happened, I mean, did you have any inkling and any indication that, you know, you might be in for such a severe condition?
Not from my memory.
Mm-hmm.
However, a friend of mine did tell me the day before that I had told him that I had the worst headache of my life, and I had it for a day or so.
Mm-hmm.
So it did seem that the aneurysm had started to affect how my brain was feeling.
Yeah. But generally there was no prior indication that something like this was going to happen and so just radically change your life.
Absolutely. Right out of the blue.
Right. So you went through, I think you said you were in a coma for a while?
Yes.
And you went through multiple years of rehabilitation, right?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
The rehabilitation, was it both physical and mental?
Yes.
Yeah. And was it also, to some degree, emotional and psychological?
Absolutely.
All right. So it was really the gamut of everything that makes John Kirkwood John Kirkwood.
Yes.
Could you tell us just a little bit about going through that, the evolution of your thinking from the time, you know, you realized what had happened and then you started on this long road back. How do you deal with something like that, knowing you got a long road ahead of you and it's, you know, it came out of nowhere and you've got to do this?
Through a fantastic support network of friends and family. I couldn't have done it without them to really know who I was as a person. Everything had been changed for me other than my persona. And that was the concerns of friends and family around me if John Kirkwood was still John Kirkwood. The way that I could adapt to my new environment, my new visual environment, my new audit, new smells, new tastes, the aspect of dealing with memory issues that couldn't get me from 1 hour to the next or 1 day to the next. It was the continuity of the people around me that kept me the same person, I feel.
And was there anyone in particular who helped you through this, or that you you really leaned on heavily during this time?
I would say that my parents were the major people that I leaned on then, and still, as they might attest to, lean on now. But
so, how old were you when this happened?
I was 36.
36, and at that point, you were working for the city of New York, plus you had your own company, City Mouse, that we talked about.
That is correct.
And we'll talk about City Mouse again a little bit more, because you've certainly resuscitated that. But when you went through the rehabilitation, at what point were you able to say, you know, I can see light at the end of the tunnel, and now I got to start thinking about what am I going to do with myself, you know, as I emerge from rehabilitation here and become John Kirkwood again?
I think I was in a program called Phase 2 at Mount Sinai, which was a rehabilitation program for people with very severe brain injuries that were working to get their life back together. And it was through that I figured out how to manage memory, how to spatially navigate even from my apartment up to Mount Sinai Hospital and get back on a schedule, on a daily schedule, and get into a routine of life that I felt like I could then bridge the gap to incorporate into society again. And it was really through that program. And during that phase, I started inquiring about the aspect of whether disability-owned businesses were looked at in the resource pool like women-owned businesses or minority-owned businesses, and none of them had heard of that. So, after a bit of digging at the new program for certification of disability-owned businesses came to light to me, and I wanted to get involved with that. So I think that the whole process of recovery it integrated into me trying to start myself back up independently as a sort of business owner.
Would it be fair to say that had you not had the aneurysm and the stroke, that the questions you asked, the digging you did about disability-owned businesses, you probably never would have gotten around to doing something like that?
I would 100% agree with that I would not have.
Yeah. Was there a particular person, a discussion, a thing that really, you know, turned that light on for you as you determined that you were going to do that?
I think it was could potentially have been vocational services for the state that I started to meet with about getting back into the work world, and not sure exactly how that thread got completed as far as getting to the stage that I am now with certifying my business.
Did you, as you were getting through the rehabilitation, did you have confidence that you'd be able to get back out into the work world and function?
I had one very strong moment that indicated otherwise to me. I remember going to the hospital, and I have an engineering and a graphic design background. I was a very visual person, and one of the things that I did was visually display information. And I was walking down the street, and I looked up at this sign, and I was going to therapy, and I was like, pots, 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 pots. Why are they selling pots here? And big red pots, octagonal red pots. That's weird. Oh. And I sat down, and I realized I was reading backwards, and it was a stop sign.
Oh.
And at that point in time, I really wondered, how am I going to work ever again if my visual perception is there that I can't even recognize a stop sign?
Hmm. Well, the I think this would probably be a good time to take a little break. What I'd like to do when we come back to for the next segment of the program is just talk for a couple of minutes, calibrate about where you are right now relative to your function, then start talking about your company, City Mouse, what it was before 2006 and what it's been since then. So how about we tackle that right after our first break?
Good.
Good. All right. We're going to take our first break. It's a short one. When we come back, we'll talk more with John Kirkwood and his journey. This is Ray Zardetto, and stay with us on Disabilities at Work Radio.
Find out what's happening on the Voice America Talk Radio Network. Find out about new shows, featured guests, and what's up this week. Find us on Facebook by searching keyword Voice America.
Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America. Become a Disabilities at Work business or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
What would you do if you knew that you could not fail? The Dr. Pat Show with Dr. Pat Basile is a radio forum for some of the world's most influential people in the fields of health, wellness, and human potential. Dr. Pat brings together and introduces visionary scientists and futurists, environmentalists, educators, business leaders, inventors, filmmakers, authors, artists, mystics, and healers who inspire and support individual and collective growth and positive cultural shifts. This award-winning radio show empowers the listening community to be the change they want to see in the world. Tune in every Thursday at 8 a.m. Pacific for the Dr. Pat Show with Dr. Pat Basile, radio to thrive by.
Stocks, bonds, investment opportunities, financial news, and talk. We can help. Call us now toll free, 866-472-5790. 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network. You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
And welcome back to Disabilities at Work Radio here on Voice America's Business Network. One of our program sponsors today is the Kessler Foundation, which is dedicated to improving the lives of the disabled through the rehabilitation research done by the Kessler Foundation Research Center and through the work of the Kessler Program Center, which helps prepare the disabled for the demands of the workplace. and on Disabilities at Work Radio. Today, our guest is John Kirkwood, founder of the internet company Sitting Mouse, but who had a long journey getting from where he was to reowning again his company Sitting Mouse. So, John, I want to get back to your story. You talked about the rehabilitation, your realization of what obstacles you still had to overcome. And I'm just wondering if you can kind of calibrate for us now exactly where you are in terms of now that you're back out in the workforce, you know, how your brain does function, how things work for you, what's different for you now than it was before everything happened in 2006.
Yes, well, speaking to how things are different, I think the major thing that I got an understanding of through the years of therapy was how I was able to commit things to memory and to manage tasks. I found that the aspect of multitasking and taking on the workload that I used to take on is virtually impossible for me without any compensatory strategies. And those compensatory strategies include recording conversations. They include taking notes of what my current status of projects are. They include diligent scheduling of items, project management, having an assistant that helps me keep to timelines. I cannot work the way that I used to without having these extra pieces in place, and that is something that I needed to learn. It was easy to just jump into something and then think, oh, wow, I actually am not going to be able to find this place that I'm going to because my spatial navigation is off. And I used to orient around something that was on the left side of the street. I can't see to the left when I'm going down the street, so I might have missed it. So I have to really prepare for situations that I didn't have to prepare for before, where I could just think things through my mind in preparation for, say, a meeting I was going to, and by the time I would get to that meeting, I would be fully prepared. Now, if I'm going to a meeting, I have to prepare for getting to the meeting.
Right.
Which is a whole different story and takes a lot of energy. And that's something other people might not even understand by looking at me, because I walk with a cane and I often wear sunglasses, but they're just visual things. They're not because I have an issue with mobility other than the issue of potentially running into someone on the street. So it's something that I've learned to compensate for, but I know that it's a lot of things that other people would say, well, that's only going to take you a short time. Why don't you do that and run over there and grab that and come back? That's something that out of the blue will derail my whole schedule of what I need to do that day. So that might answer your question or might not, but it gives an idea of what I've been going through, I think.
No, I think it does. I think it's also very enlightening for our audience to know that, because, as you know, many of the people who listen to this program have to deal with their own challenges and disabilities, and I think it's good for them to know that people who have, you know, made it through, who have found ways to overcome the obstacles, you know, have overcome obstacles probably just as great, just as challenging as the ones that that they face every day. So,
if not more so, but yeah, they have.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think it's good to get a grounding like that before we start talking about the business aspect of your career and everything, so people kind of know that. But anyway, why don't you talk about Sitting Mouse for a couple of minutes? Why did you originally found Sitting Mouse in its first iteration some years ago?
I founded it because I saw the need for website development companies. This was very much the early days of the internet. I created the first website for the city of New York called NYC Link, and a lot of government agencies needed help in creating their online initiatives. I've always been one that worked and wanted to work in public service and work for the greater good, I've always hoped. And I found that there were some nonprofits out there that didn't have the proper services online, and they wanted to create better services. So that's why I created my company to begin with.
And about, you know, I mean, I don't know if you, how far along City Mouse had come by the time you had your aneurysm in 2006. About how many clients at that point were you?
I only had a few different clients.
Right. So it'd be fair to characterize it as building the business. You're in a phase of building the business at that point.
Yes.
Yeah.
I had split attention, I guess, at that point. A psychological term, I know at this point, where I was doing the government work and also City Mouse. I was never looking at City Mouse to sort of take over everything. It was always a way that I could do the other fun stuff for clients that I wanted to work with.
Mm-hmm. So I guess in some ways then there was already this existing synergy between City Mouse and what you envisioned it to be and what you decided you wanted to do as you got through real rehabilitation then.
Yes.
Okay. Why don't you talk a little bit about City Mouse today and what are some of the things you do? I know when you look at some of the things you have or some of the information you have on the website that we've talked about, you really want to put a focus now, from what I understand, with City Mouse on communications for persons with disabilities, the Americans with Disabilities Act, and many of the other things related to people with disabilities.
That's correct. Yes, I want to have as the primary focus of City Mouse to reach out to qualified disabled people to execute its services of making communications that are accessible to all. And I think that is an underserved community from what I have seen. I've seen how the internet development has evolved over time, and often it zips into flashing bells and whistles, and those sort of applications are not ones that are accessible to all. They might look fancy if you've got the fastest computer with the greatest browser and flash player on it, and it's developed by some young designer who's a great designer, but they're probably not concerned with making the website ADA compliant. And that is something that I'm going to focus around, is to make websites that are ADA compliant and make them open to all, really.
What are some of the characteristics that would be involved in making it ADA compliant, the websites?
Yes, some of the characteristics are proper tagging of images so that an image that cannot be seen by someone who's visually impaired will have proper descriptions of the images. That the navigation of the website is made so that compensatory technologies can move around the screen and get to the buttons that they need to press. That there's not extraneous code saying about say the color and shape of bullets, when that is information that a screen reader would pick up, but someone that is not visually impaired wouldn't see. So there can be things that are in the code that end up making it very messy for other people.
And I'm just curious, I don't know if you know the answer to this, but what percentage of websites in existence are ADA compliant at this point? Do you have any idea?
No, I do not. I think
I'm going to guess it's fairly minimal, though.
I think it is, and it's difficult to even standardize on what ADA compliance, quote-unquote ADA compliance, is, because compensatory technologies evolve as well. So I think that there's got to be, there is a standardizing body that can give you information about that, and there is multiple ways that one can make a site ADA compliant, but this is all evolving.
Okay. I'm just wondering also, do you have any consulting role with any government agencies, whether it's still the City of New York or anything, with regard to making their sites more ADA compliant?
Not at this point in time.
Yeah. Would you like to, though?
Yes, I think I would.
I think it would be, it sounds like it would be something that would be helpful for any number of agencies and levels of government, not just New York City, but statewide, even federal. So maybe that's something that needs to be looked into. I want to talk a little bit more about City Mouse and everything with you when we come back. John, we're going to take another break. And I want to talk about City Mouse from the standpoint of some of the folks you you work with, and its place, or its place in the entire people with disabilities workplace environment. But first, let me thank Koresh and Associates and ASL Interpreter Referral Services for their generosity in making our Disabilities at Work radio program accessible to the deaf and the hard of hearing. Transcripts of our program will be available on our website, disabilitiesatwork.org, 1 week following each episode. And as long as we're talking about our website, let me ask you or invite you to please check out our new newsletter. It started this year. It's posted on the website. It's called Disabilities at Work, and it's free. And it provides a lot of information about many of the topics we discuss on the program, and it's also a great source of information about the issues surrounding employment of people with disabilities. So check it out at disabilitiesatwork.org. And don't forget to follow us on Twitter at disabilitiesat, and join the thousands of people worldwide now who have connected with us on Facebook. We'll be back with John Kirkwood in just a moment. I'm Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
Stay connected.
Sign up for our newsletter.
Go beyond your favorite Voice America shows. Visit iradioblog.com.
Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America. Become a Disabilities at Work business or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
No family can survive on two incomes anymore, let alone one. If you are supplementing your family's income working from home, then tune into The Cash Flow Show, Direct Sales Radio. Host Deb Bixler brings you sales tips, lead generation systems, and best business practices that guarantee direct sales success. Whether you're looking for a little extra cash or a career change, The Cash Flow Show, Direct Sales Radio will give you proven systems that will work in your home business. The Cash Flow Show. Show every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, 5 p.m. Pacific Time on the Voice America Business Channel.
Up-to-date business and financial news. Call now and get the financial information you need. 866-472-5790. 866-472-5790.
The experts are here.
Voice America Business Network. You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
And we're back on Voice America's Business Network, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio. I'm Ray Zardetto, and today's show is sponsored by the New Jersey Division of Disability Services, part of the state of New Jersey's Division of Human Services. And the division focuses on helping people who have become disabled as adults so they can live lives more independently in their communities. My guest today, John Kirkwood, former employee of the City of New York, and the once and current president and owner and founder of City Mouse, an internet consulting company. John was a few years back felled by, but not stopped by, a brain aneurysm and a stroke. But after years of rehabilitation, John is back behind the wheel at City Mouse, which is where we left off the conversation before the last break. John, one of the things you touched on very quickly in the last segment was the fact that your business was disability certified, and I assume that was by the USBLN, the Business Leadership Network?
That is correct.
Why don't you talk a little bit about what that is and then why you think it's important that businesses like yours be certified that year that way? What does it mean to the business community at large?
Yes, I got certified by the USBLN and U.S. Business Leadership Network in 2010, and it is a certification process that is moving to promote businesses that are owned by people with disabilities, and to get them into the vendor streams of various large businesses throughout the country. And with that certification, I'm hoping to be able to approach new clients and be able to market the company in ways that I might not be able to do just as a singular resource.
And the certification you get from the USBLN suggests or says that you are a majority-owned or a majority disability-owned business. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Why is that important to the business community, do you think, the business community at large?
Well, I think that that the whole aspect of the certification of minority-owned businesses, women-owned businesses, and now disability-owned businesses gives these businesses an entree into a vendor stream that maybe they wouldn't have been seen so easily. Also, the support of this network can show how successful these businesses are, that there is a reputation that is at play here where people want to show that they are able to do the things that they are showing that they are promoting. And to get the support of this network allows this small business community to get into these vendor streams.
And so if I work for a company or corporation and part of my strategy or part of the goals we've set out is to do more business with some either minority-owned, women-owned, or disability-owned businesses, looking for this certification is something I can use to help me find some of these suppliers that way. Is that right?
That's correct, yes.
Right. Okay. I also noticed that as you reconstituted your business in the last couple of years, that you've been getting some outside help, mentoring support and everything from, I think it's Columbia University, is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Is that something that they do in general, do you know? Is that part of a program that they offer to a lot of businesses?
That is a general program for graduates of Columbia University, definitely. I'm not sure what the outreach is for that mentorship program.
Okay.
And also there's the program from LaGuardia Community College that's their small business development center that is integrated by, I think it's the State University of New York and the U.S. Small Business Administration. So that is an open program that I think any up-and-coming business can seek the services from.
And the Columbia mentoring or mentorship program that you just you mentioned, what exactly does that do for you?
Yeah, it gives me access to some business-minded engineering alumni that have successful businesses out there to allow my company to have an understanding of what the markets are and what is around building a successful business. I'm in the beginning steps of the process with them, and we've been going through the business plan and how we're going to approach different markets with my services.
I'm just curious, is the program or the mentors in the program, are they faculty from Columbia, or do they bring in business people?
I think they're engineering faculty
and
business people, actually.
It's both, so. And it's open to graduates of Columbia.
This is my understanding, yes.
Okay, and so lucky you. You were a graduate of Columbia, right?
For this program, definitely. Yes.
and the other program you mentioned, which is part of the LaGuardia Community College, what exactly does that provide?
There's a business development center. I think it's it's called New York Designs, and it provides an incubator for businesses that they can bounce ideas off other people with startup businesses within this office space and use their facilities and work with the resources that the other small companies have available to them as well.
Hmm. Okay. Well, I'm just curious, at this point now, it's a few years that you've been at this again since you reconstituted City Mouse and are going again. Did you think you'd be as far along as you are right now?
I think I can say yes and no, and they would both be right. You know, it's very difficult for me to judge my own progress, I think.
Yeah.
And from the input that I'm getting from people around me, I'm gonna go with no.
Well, you can look at it as you just have more opportunities ahead of you. That's all.
Right. Yeah.
You have a couple of other employees at City Mouse.
I have a full-time assistant that's helping me out with keeping me on track of things, as I said before. And I have a business partner that I used to work with in the past to help me relaunch things as well. So we're very much at our startup stage, and we're looking to expand the number of people working for City Mouse and around the ethos that I said before.
And I think you've expressed an interest as you talk about expanding the business that a lot of the people you want to hire would be people with disabilities.
Most definitely.
Yeah. Talk about that for a few minutes. You know, in what kind of capacities, in what way would you go about doing it? Just your overall thinking with regard to that.
Yeah, my thinking is that people that would know the best on how well internet sites are working in regards to compliance with Disability Act or just in regards to usability would be the disability community. So therefore, I would really like to bring people in that have been using the internet for a while and that see the missteps that are out there, the things that do work, the things that don't work, and how they can be resolved. And that's where I feel like I can really reach out to the disability community as far as employment is concerned and moving City Mouse forward in that direction.
Okay. And by the way, where is City Mouse located? Is it in New York City?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I'd like to talk some more about the implications of your decisions to try and move the ball forward in terms of hiring people with disabilities, and talk a little bit more philosophically with you about people with disabilities in the workplace, and what you would advise them, what you would advise potential employers of them. I think that'd be very interesting, but we have to take one more break first before we can do that. So if you'd stay with us, John, we're going to take this break, and we will be back in just a moment. This is Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
Get the news on our shows and other happenings by following us on Twitter. Find us at VoiceAmericaTRN or Twitter.com/VoiceAmericaTRN.
Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America, become a Disabilities at Work business, or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
If you are looking for creative ways to improve your bottom line, tune in to Make Your Move with Alan and Brian Bolio. Their proven track record of helping businesses enhance their profitability will provide the basis for a forum about actionable items based on a business person's perspective. The program will be business talk, but with an economic context, so you'll know how to stay ahead of the game. Make Your Move is broadcast live every Monday afternoon at 4 p.m. Eastern Time, 1 p.m. Pacific Time on the Voice America Business Channel.
Whether the market's up or down, or if you're looking to improve your portfolio, our experts are ready to talk to you. Call now, toll free, 866-472-5790. That's 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network.
You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
And welcome back to Disabilities at Work Radio. I'm Ray Zardetto, speaking on today's program with John Kirkwood. And, John, we were talking just a few minutes ago about your interest in bringing people with disabilities into City Mouse, your internet consulting and development company. And we talked a little bit about how you might go about doing that. I'm curious, you've described and discussed in detail your own disabilities, and I know some of them may be more obvious and some of them may be hidden. And I'm wondering, from your standpoint, if somebody who's listening to the program today has his or her own disabilities to deal with, how would you advise them relative to dealing with that disability if they're looking for a job? And then I also want to ask you how you think they should deal with the disability if they're already in the workplace and it's kind of a hidden disability. Do you think they should make it known to their coworkers and their boss, or should they not? So let's take these one at a time, I guess. What would you say to somebody who's managing or trying to work with their own disabilities and looking for a job right now?
I think that there are resources out there that specifically cater to people looking for employment that have a disability. I also think that there is a big effort to show what the advantages are of hiring people with disabilities. I was definitely at some interesting conferences around the hiring practices of some large businesses of people with disabilities. And one of the things that they've really shown is that the job satisfaction and the satisfaction of the workers for people with disabilities is generally higher than people without disabilities. So that aspect of focusing on the positive rather than the perceived inability to do something is what I think can really move things forward.
What do you find is the single biggest obstacle that you think there is in terms of hiring managers, human resources professionals who are looking at or thinking about hiring people with disabilities?
My feeling on that is that there is a problem with perception, and that somehow there it's going to be more difficult to work with someone with a disability, or that the company might not have the procedures in place to properly comply with regulations or laws around people with disabilities. But I'm kind of guessing on this one.
So. Yeah, I know it's more from your own perception of it, but that's what I'm interested in here. In a number of programs we've done over the last year, we've talked to people who have disabilities that they manage in one way or another. Some of them are more obvious, some of them are more hidden. And a lot of times we get into discussions about whether people who have disabilities that are more or less hidden, should they reveal them to their employers? Should they, you know, reveal them to the coworkers, or should they not? And I don't know if you have any opinion or perspective on that.
Yeah. From my personal perspective, I really feel like it's best to not try and hide something and to put it out on the table so that there's not a miscommunication in the future. I do it every day with just walking to meet someone potentially in a restaurant and telling them, look, I might not be able to find my way back to the table that we are at.
Mm-hmm.
So could you keep that in mind, or don't be insulted if I pass by you on the street and don't say anything. So I might look like I could see someone, but the reality is I have missed something. So if they know right off the bat that this person doesn't necessarily know that I've done this, it's almost empowering for both people. They have the opportunity to almost be kind and say, hey, you know, but I'm sorry, I was just, you come over this way because of that over there. Like, oh, thank you. You know, and it's good for all people. You know, it's if it's upfront, then I don't find that there are those miscommunications. And I almost feel like people are more psychologically open to you because you've told them a little something about yourself. And I think it can make people feel more comfortable.
Hmm. Do you find... In dealing with people since your aneurysm, that it works better if you kind of take the lead in that regard in terms of setting the parameters of the discussion and what you can and can't say? Because I think a lot of times people aren't sure what's the appropriate thing to do or say, you know, when they're talking to someone who has a disability. So do you find it's better if you kind of set the parameters right away up front?
I find it best if I make the effort to communicate something to them, yes, because then I think one can almost see an anxiety in someone's face when they're trying to figure out how to communicate something, and they don't want to miscommunicate. So
right.
I think that they might not have the tools to do it because it could be very difficult to understand what someone else's quote-unquote disability is.
Okay. So getting back to City Mouse, then, we'll close out the program for the last few minutes again, talking about your business, City Mouse. First of all, for those folks who might want to know, where can they find more information or get in touch with City Mouse?
More information can be found on my website. The URL is citymouse.com, C-I-T-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
Okay.
And I can be emailed anytime at kirkwood@citymouse.com.
And that's K-I-R-K-W-O-O-D, Kirkwood.
That's correct.
Okay. So what are some of the projects City Mouse is looking at doing or currently involved in that that are involved in what you talked about earlier, the supporting or getting the word out more on people with disabilities?
Well, that is very much in the incubation stage, as I said, and the projects are going to be around working with companies to get their websites ADA compliant.
Do you also find that just doing any kind of general publicity, whether it's the show or other shows, mm-hmm. any kind of general publicity about people with disabilities and the kinds of successes that they can avail themselves of, that would help in terms of this campaign?
Yes, and I would love to promote other businesses even on my website that are doing like businesses or are also disability-owned businesses or have an interest in this. So
good.
That
well,
I wanted.
I think that'd be a great thing. So again, tell us the URL for City Mouse.
It is citymouse.com.
All right, get a hold of John Kirkwood and make it happen.
That'd be great.
All right, John. Listen, I appreciate you coming on the show and being as open and as frank as you've been about what happened to you and your long road back. And you know, first I want to thank you for that, and secondly, offer my congratulations to you for what you've been able to do. It's a great story.
Anytime, it's an honor.
Thank you. Let me also thank today our sponsors, the Kessler Foundation and the New Jersey Division of Disability Services. And finally, a thanks to Karash & Associates and ASL Interpreter Referral Service for their generosity in making Disabilities at Work accessible to the deaf and to the hard of hearing. Transcripts of our program will be available on our website, disabilitiesatwork.org, a week following each episode. I want to thank you all for being with us here today. Join us again next Wednesday at noon Eastern Time on the Voice America Business Network. I'm Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
Thanks for listening to Disabilities at Work. Become part of our team on Twitter at Disabilities At and friend us on Facebook at Disabilities at Work. Check out our website at www.disabilitiesatwork.org and join us next week on Wednesday, 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern Time for the next Disabilities at Work radio show. Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America, become a Disabilities at Work business, or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
Thanks again for listening to the preceding program, brought to you on the Voice America Business Channel. For more information about our network and to check out additional show hosts and topics of interest, please visit voiceamericabusiness.com. The Voice America Talk Radio Network is the worldwide leader in live Internet talk radio. Visit voiceamerica.com. The views and ideas expressed on the preceding program are strictly those of the host or guests and do not necessarily reflect the views and ideas held by the Voice America Talk Radio Network, its staff, and management.